Father, we're grateful to you for the opportunity we have to study your word. It's quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. It cuts asunder the truth from fiction. And in our own lives, Lord, we see the word of God dividing the truth from falsehood. And we're grateful for that. Thank you for the group gathered together today to study your word. And thank you for those who will join us in any way that they join us, those on the phone and those who will be joining by watching the video of the Bible study today. I pray, Lord, that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be acceptable to you. And I pray that your word would come alive to us. Thank you for chapter after chapter in the book of Acts that remind us that the early New Testament church was a house that prayer built. And Father, we know that that's really the only kind of church that you can bless is a house that prayer builds, that our communication with you, we hear from you, we talk to you, we learn from you, and you are the one who grows the church and builds the church. Lord Jesus, thank you that you said you would build your church and the gates of hell would not prevail against it. So we're grateful to study your word this morning, and I pray that you will speak clearly to each one of us, and then you will hear us today as we pray. Father, our country is in such desperate need of you, and we can hardly even turn on TV or the computer or pick up a magazine or a newspaper that we're just not so much aware of how much darkness we live in now, and Lord, it's everywhere. So we thank you that your word speaks to us and challenges us, and I pray that that will happen this day, and that you would hear our prayer for repentance and for healing of our land today. All this we pray, thanking you for every goodness and every blessing. Thank you for this beautiful day that the Lord has made. We rejoice and we're glad in it. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Well, today we're in Acts 18. That means we've done 17 chapters in Acts, and we've had 17 references in Acts to prayer. Some chapters in Acts have more than one reference to prayer. Some of them are almost all prayer, and others just have some references that are, you might say, sometimes they are sort of not just a direct, it's sort of an indirect reference to prayer, but definitely a reference to prayer, and that's true in Acts chapter 18. Verse 1 says that after these things, that was after Paul had preached his sermon on Mars Hill, and the philosophers there heard him, and they were divided over his gospel message that he brought. And let me cut that off. Then I heard it right now rather than getting into it. They were divided over the gospel message that Paul brought there, and some did believe and wanted him to say more about the resurrection, because that was the issue that divided those Greek philosophers in Athens. And after that, the Bible says in Acts 18, verse 1, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth from Greece to Rome, and found a certain Jew named Aquila, who was born in, my eyes are blurred, just now. They found a Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy, with his wife Priscilla. Aquila and Priscilla were two persons that Paul enjoyed getting to know, because they had the same vocation that he did, tent making. And the three of them had a lot in common. Then, verse 4, he reasoned with them in the synagogue with the people who were there, and persuaded the Jews and the Greeks. And then it goes on to say that there was opposition that happens so very often. And verse 6, and when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, he shook his raiment, took his robe and shook it, and said to them, your blood be upon your own heads, I am clean. from henceforth, I will go to the Gentiles. Here's a big transition that's happening. The Apostle Paul continuing to reason with Jewish people to believe the gospel and finding over and over again opposition to that and saying, okay, I'm going to go and share the gospel with the Gentiles. And so he does two believers come to know the Lord, and many others also, verse 8. And then verse 9, here's our key today. Then the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision and said, do not be afraid, but speak, and do not hold your peace. For I am with you, and no man shall set on you to hurt you. For I have many people in this city. Interesting prayer time. You know, sometimes God speaks to us in the darkest night clearer than he does in the brightest day. The Apostle Paul had several nighttime visions of the Lord, and this is one of them, where he had seen opposition, he had seen blasphemy against him and against the gospel. He had seen people rise up and, you know, try to harm him and all of that. And in the middle of the night, the Lord spoke to him. A vision came to him. So this is a prayer experience with God speaking to Paul. And obviously, Paul listening, being in on the end of that. Does God speak to people today like he did to the Apostle Paul? Excuse me. I believe he does. I believe he first of all speaks to us through this. Mm-hmm. He has given us his word, and so his word is the measurement by which we measure voices that we hear, or signals that we get, or signs that we see. You know, I hear a lot of preachers on television and so forth, and they say, and God spoke to me and he said, and they kind of give the conversation. I usually want to say, wait now. You know, really God has already, he's already spoken to us. We can hear him clearly through his word, and most of the time, God does not need to come to us and speak some kind of word through a vision. Now, the Bible had not yet been put together at this time. So in the early New Testament days, God did speak in unusual ways, and his Holy Spirit worked in unusual ways. But then once the Word of God was complete, Old Testament and New, the Old Covenant and the New Covenant, God began to preserve his Word in amazing ways. You know, not only the inspiration of the Scripture that God inspired men over all these hundreds of years to write down the history of God at work among his people, how God speaks to his people and so forth, write that down, but that he's preserved his Word so completely. It's just amazing. I think some of you heard me mention, when I was in college, There was a teaching that one of the books in the Old Testament was actually three different books. That we were taught that there was Isaiah, the first part of Isaiah, and then there was Deutero-Isaiah, written by somebody else other than Isaiah, and then there was even Treto-Isaiah, a third part of Isaiah, none of those last two, which were actually written by Isaiah the prophet, or written by somebody else. This was kind of a liberal approach to Scripture. I did go to a Baptist school, but there were some liberal teachings that were already infiltrating into that Baptist school. And so one of our textbooks taught that. Now, a few years later, I went to Israel, where they have now, you know, uncovered the scroll of Isaiah the prophet. And so it's not the very original, very first written, it's a copy of a copy, about like that, of Isaiah's scroll. But as they put it in a building, and you can walk around it, it's in the panoramic view, you can just walk around it. It's sealed, you know, because parchment gets old and decays and rots and breaks and so forth. So they've got it hermetically, I guess is the right word, sealed. And you can walk around it. And I asked my guide, I said, now, where's the break between Isaiah 39 and Isaiah 40? Now, right here, he could read the Hebrew right here, here, here. Isaiah 39 just flows right into Isaiah 40. There's no break. And so here is almost the very original copy of the book of Isaiah without any kind of break or, you know, in fact, they didn't have the verses and chapters, you know, like we have, but he knew how to read right, that place that would go from Isaiah 39 to 40. No break, indicating to me these very earliest documents are what we really go back to. And when you find those earliest parchments and documents, you can find how God has preserved his word from the original down to what we have today. Now, am I saying that there are absolutely no differences between the very earliest originals and what we have today? No, I'm not saying that. There may be a few, but nothing that changes the historical, the scientific, the theological meaning of those original documents. You know, we believe that there was a Caesar. We believe that there was a Nero. We believe that these Roman people existed. But do you know, the copies of the history of those guys are like a copy of 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 a copy. There are not many books of antiquity that go back to the closest original writings than the Bible. And yet, nobody seems to say, well, I don't know if there was a Nero. I mean, we got a copy of a copy of a copy of a copy, and maybe Nero didn't exist, and maybe Rome didn't get burned like you know, some of these history books say and so forth. They don't seem to doubt that. What they seem to doubt is the veracity of the Bible, the Word of God, even though other historical documents are less reliable than the documents that we have for the Bible. I don't know why I'm going into that particular detail. I didn't intend to do that, except to say, yes, God does speak to us today. I think we get promptings from the Holy Spirit. We've talked about guidance, you know, that He does guide us. He does give us direction. But I think the main source that we go to hear from God is the Bible. But in these earliest days, God did indeed speak directly to His servants. They did not yet have the full document of the Bible. So the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision. Now, has he ever done that before? Yeah, just a couple of chapters back when he spoke to Paul in a vision and said, no, I don't want you to go here, I want you to go here. And the Apostle Paul came on to Philippi, where Gentiles, Greeks, and so forth were gathered, and the gospel began to come to us Gentiles, non-Jewish people. The Lord directed him. So now he's speaking to him again, in the night by a vision, and look to the things that God said to him. Number one, be not afraid. You know, I think one of the first things God says to us, don't be afraid. Now, always when angels came, practically every time an angel appears to somebody in the Bible, the first two words they say, fear not. Because, I mean, I guess if one appeared right here in the room today, in all his angelic glory and all of his radiance and power, the first thing he'd have to say, y'all, don't be afraid. You know, this is okay. It's all right. But now, in this instance, it's not an angel. It's God himself speaking. We're assuming it's not an angel. It's a vision, but it seems that God's voice, by the way, what do you think it sounds like? I used to always think it sounded like it sounds in the movies, you know, like the Ten Commandments. And so you have this music in the background, this heavenly kind of music, and God speaks, you know, like from the throne. And
sound like Darth Vader in Star Wars.
A lot like his voice. Maybe Hollywood uses that voice, same voice for God's voice sometimes. And so naturally I got that kind of Hollywood idea of how God... I don't think it's like that at all. I think God speaks in a very understandable way and clearly. I don't know what his voice sounded like. I heard years ago somebody said, have you ever heard God speak? By the way, the pastor who preceded me at Central Baptist Church in Decatur, Alabama, where I went to from here in the late 70s, was preaching one morning on the second coming, and in the middle of his message he was saying, God is going to come down, the Lord Jesus is going to come with a trumpet blast and a light from the sky. And right at that very moment when he said that, one of the huge television lights exploded. Boom! Like that. They had 27 people saved that morning. I don't know about that part, but people remember that story from the very timing that he mentioned about the Lord Jesus bursting through the sky and there was that light, boom. So maybe somehow or other the power going out can help us remember how God does indeed speak to us. So now that little chime doesn't mean...
I mean somebody came into the meeting.
Yeah, okay, all right.
Good. The internet's back up, but you're on your phone, so just keep that.
Okay, all right, so good. So you people who are watching us on the line there, sorry about all that interruption, but we're talking about God speaking to Paul in the night, and his first two words, fear not, or be not afraid. You know, you think about all of the fears that people have, the phobias that people have. People are, what is the number, do you know still today, it's been for a long time, generally speaking, the number one fear that at least Americans have?
Public speaking.
Public speaking.
And number two is death.
And number two is what?
Death.
And
they're more afraid to talk in front of people than they are to die, which is
yeah,
kind of
right, right. So that has remained for a long, long time that the fear of public speaking is one of the top fears. Death, spiders, snakes, those kind of come in there in the first top 10 fears that people have. Being in close quarters, claustrophobia, being in high places, what is that, acrophobia, I think, you know, all those different phobias. And then, of course, there's the phobia, which is the fear itself, you know, and that's not really one, that's just made up, but there's just so many fears. People are afraid. So, you know, it's not just when God speaks to us or when an angel comes that he needs to assure us, don't be afraid. I think a lot of times a good question is, what do you fear the most? What is your main fear? Yes, June?
Why is it, and maybe everybody else is not like me, but why is it that we as Christians have such a fear of reaching out and talking to other people about being saved?
That's exactly where we're coming to in just a minute, because one of the things God says to him is, be not afraid, but speak and do not hold your peace. Apparently, the Lord knew that even the Apostle Paul had to be assured that that's something you don't need to be afraid of. But so the answer is, I suppose it's our human nature. And I suppose it has to do with the fear of rejection. You know, we're feeling like if we say something, somebody will think we're crazy, or somebody will reject us from that. And you know, I think was it one of the prophets that God spoke to and said, "Hey, don't be afraid. They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me when you speak for me, and you know, somebody doesn't like it or somebody gets offended." So I think basically it has to do with us feeling like we might get rejected or somebody might consider us crazy or off the wall or something like that.
Or I won't do it right.
Yeah. Was it the Apostle Paul who said, "Hey, I'm okay to be considered a fool for Christ"? You know, so it. And I remember hearing years ago, I was just young, somebody preached a message on, "Whose fool are you?" And talking about, you know, how we can be so crazy about some things, and we can dress in some crazy way, or we can get on some crazy fad, or, you know, something like that. But we don't want to be called a fool or crazy about spiritual things and about the Lord. So I think the answer is the basic desire to be accepted, and the basic fear of being rejected. I believe that's why we do it. But, you know, when we consider the fact that we might be one of the stop signs to somebody on the way to hell, then we say, well, if they consider me crazy, that's just it. I'm still going to bear witness.
So. Well, I've lived on my street since 92.
Uh-huh.
And just recently, I just feel compelled to go from door to door and introduce myself and introduce the people there to Jesus.
Amen, June. Amen.
And I think it is safe now.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah.
I think we're through COVID enough.
Right. And so people won't be afraid of that part of it. Mm-hmm. Right.
And, so just pray for me because that just keeps on recurring. And then all of these things, you know, start getting in the way.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
of course. Yeah.
Keep you from doing it.
Yeah.
It's either raining or.
Cold, too cold. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah, my bathroom sprung a leak and we had to redo carpets and so forth. So, but pray for me because
Amen.
I feel like that I need to know my neighbors.
Amen. Amen.
And
good.
I have talked with my neighbors that are closer to me.
Uh-huh.
But I don't know who lives
two or three more doors down.
And it's a short street.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Is it a cul-de-sac?
It's a dead-end street.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And goes into the... I'm on the Rosebank side of Upland. And it dead-ends into the mansion up there.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, let's just pause and have a prayer right here now. Father, we're talking about exactly what happened here in this text with you speaking to the Apostle Paul, that vibrant missionary for you, and yet you had to assure him to not be afraid and that you were going to be with him and that he was not going to have to suffer from rejection and pain and so forth. And so, Lord, we lift up June to you in this desire. I don't think Satan gave her that desire. I don't think it just came out of the flesh. I think she was given that by you, a desire to be a missionary in her neighborhood and on her street. And I pray that you'll give her a holy boldness to be able to knock on those doors and introduce herself and introduce you, Lord Jesus, to her neighbors that are just right there around it. And that would also be an inspiration to each of us, Father, to be a missionary on our street and to be more bold in our witness to our neighbors and to think of ways that we can proclaim the gospel right around us. Lord, we know if all of your people scattered throughout every community would have that kind of burden, we would see revival break out. We would see America come back to you because we're scattered everywhere and we could be that kind of witness. So thank you for this word today that's so applicable to what we're studying. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, great, June. That certainly fits with this, with the Apostle Paul being told not to be afraid, but speak, he said, and not hold your peace. Holding your peace means just not saying anything. You know, you just don't bear a witness. So I think that's great. So the first two commands from God in this prayer vision is don't be afraid and don't be ashamed. And then he goes from that to promises. Look at the promises in verse 10. For I am with you. Is there any greater promise anywhere in the scriptures than that? That the Lord has promised to be with us. Whatever it is we're going through, he is with us. Whatever we're facing, he is with us. I am with you. You know, the very last words that Jesus said to us before he ascended up into heaven is, go and make disciples, baptize those disciples in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and I am with you always, even to the end of the age. I think that means as we go, he is with us. But I think it means also whatever you're facing, whatever you're dealing with, I am with you. I don't know of any greater promise that we have than God's presence, that he is with us. You remember the little boy that came and tried to get in the bed with his dad, and the dad scooted him back into his bed, and you know, they had a kind of a conversation, and it ended up with the dad trying to teach his son, "Son, the Lord has promised to be with you always, and just remember that the Lord is with you." And he said, "Yeah, Dad, but I want somebody with skin on." You remember that? So sometimes we kind of want somebody we can reach out and touch, somebody with skin on. But what ought to satisfy us is God's promise that he is with us. We don't have to say, "Lord, would you be with me?" Because we can say, "Lord, I thank you that you're with me in this. You're going ahead of me. You're accompanying me. You are with me. For I am with you." And then look at the next part of that promise. "And no man shall set on thee to hurt thee." What other translation does somebody have? What other phrase do you have in your...
"I am with you, and no one is going to attack and harm you."
No one is going to attack or harm you. What? Yeah, okay. So, in other words, is he saying there's not going to be anybody who won't like what you say? No. Is there not going to be anybody who will resent it? No, he's not saying that. He's saying that as long as you are in the middle of my will, you are invulnerable to hurt. I'm surrounding you. I'm covering you. It means we're not going to stumble, not going to stump our toe, or not going to break a leg, or no. I don't think that's not what it means. Does it mean that somebody's not going to hurt our feelings? No, that's not what it means. But it means that in the will of God, we are protected, and he is going to keep us from having permanent hurt from those who would hurt us. So again, why wouldn't we be bold in our witness? Why wouldn't we be forthright in sharing the gospel? And then the last part of the promise is so very clear when he says, "For I have much people in this city." You know, the Apostle Paul is thinking around, hey, here's Athens, here's Corinth, here are these places where pagan leaders are leading, where pagan people are more populated. We're kind of in the majority. And God, I think he's saying two things. I think he's saying, there are a lot of people seeking me here. And I think he's saying, there are a lot of people who secretly have found me. You may not know it, but I know people who have come to the Lord. There's an Old Testament story that makes us think of this. When God is reminding Paul that there are a lot of people in the city. Remember? The prophet Elijah, remember he crawled under the juniper tree and said, "Lord, I'm just giving up. Just take my life. I'm the only one." Remember him coming up with that? There's no other body that's following you. And then God reminding him, "No, listen, I've got, 7,000 that have not, bowed down to Baal, that are still my people." And you know, so sometimes God just needs to remind you. Cut on the TV, you listen to the news, you look at the paper, or you look at the celebrities and the people who are speaking, and you think, "Man, I believe I must be the only person who believes like this, or the only person walking with the Lord." No, here God is assuring the Apostle Paul, "I have much people in this city." I think it means much potential people. Don't be afraid to share the gospel. And I think it means much people who found me, but yet they have not spoken out. You don't know it, but they are here. So I think that kind of promise to us, that kind of exhortation, don't be afraid, don't be ashamed. I'm with you. Nobody's going to be able to hurt you in a permanent way. I have many people in this city. That kind of promise to us is a promise to call us to prayer and to call us to proclamation. Amen? So that study and that prayer experience. Any comments before we pray together, because I want to share something with you in prayer.
I think one thing is too,
yes,
that
Judy,
to always be aware that the Spirit is leading you in that, because sometimes you can speak up too soon and scare people away.
Okay, yeah. Be cautious about people. Try to now, going from house to house, we don't have time to do this. You're getting acquainted. but you're also letting people know who you are and what you represent and so forth, to be able to close somebody out, so to speak, go ahead and lead them to the Lord. We have to be certain that their receptivity level is such that the Spirit can strive with them, that the Spirit can speak with them. And so sometimes to go up to somebody carrying our big family Bible or whatever and pressing in on them can be offensive. So we have to be sensitive to where people are, but at the same time, not so sensitive that we're not bold in our witness for Christ. So that fine, delicate balance is very important. Okay, I've got a little sheet. Have you gotten that already? Yeah. I think Don and Jonathan have helped distribute that. This is something that I have put together some time back on fasting and praying for revival. We've talked in this study about fasting already. But with the day of prayer coming up tomorrow, the National Day of Prayer, and by the way, that National Day of Prayer has been issued by most of our presidents who've come along, including Joe Biden. He has said something publicly about the National Day of Prayer. So it's not, it's not something that's brand new to us. Now we'll move on into the next few minutes of prayer. What this sheet is, this prayer sheet, is about kind of praying for the house. You remember that Jesus said to the people who came into the temple, my house shall be called a house of prayer. So I'm going to be talking with you about houses of prayer, so to speak. And as we pray, thinking about tomorrow, the National Day of Prayer, the first house that we need to pray about is the house that we live in, our body. Romans 12, 1 and 2, that's where the Apostle Paul said that we are to yield our bodies a living sacrifice. We're to give our bodies, we're to present our bodies. And notice my comments here. Present your whole body to the Lord and pray for a revival inside you. Think about your eyes and ears, what you see and hear, your mouth, what you say, your hands, what you do, your feet, where you go. Think about your heart, how you feel, your mind, what you think, your spirit, that is your attitude, your disposition, your personality, your use of time. Pray for your stomach and other parts of your body, your drives and your appetites, that they will be subject to God and that you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. And then consider how much of your time and thoughts usually center around eating, and use such a time to seek God's face and be in touch with Him. So the first part of the prayer would be for our individual, if you think about dropping a rock into a body of water, a lake, and you see the concentric circles, the ripples that go around that, that's kind of what we're doing here today, thinking about a National Day of Prayer and our own day of prayer, that it needs to begin right in our own bodies. So let's bow together in a moment of prayer. And would you just think, rather than, as we move along, I'd like for you to pray out loud. But on this one, let's just pray silently this day. And let's continue using this sheet tomorrow and in days ahead about our own bodies. Eyes and ears and hands and feet and our insides, so to speak, and our attitudes and our dispositions and our words that we speak and the words that we hear, that God would indeed indwell our bodies. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Our body is that. And that's the reason I feel like it's important to keep it fit as much as possible, to be as healthy as we possibly can, and to allow our bodies to be God's temple and God's witness, and not let them get neglected and not let them get in bad condition, but to honor the Lord through. So let's just have a silent moment of prayer, and would each of us commit our body in a new, fresh way to the Lord. Present our body. Lord, here I am. You know, the little boy that brought his fives and twos, you know, that had in his lunch five loaves and two fish. Well, we've got our fives and twos, you know, our five fingers and two hands, five fingers on each hand and two hands, our five toes and on each foot and two feet, our two ears, our two eyes, our two lips, you know, all our fives and twos, the five elements that we make up, seeing and hearing, all the fives and twos that God's given us, and like the little boy, let's present our bodies to the Lord, like he presented his lunch to Jesus, and ask him to use our physical bodies as his temple to glorify him. Father, thank you for hearing our individual prayers, and we do ask you to have your own way. Take our hands, take our feet, take our eyes, take our ears, our mouth. Lord, take our bodies and let them be exactly what you want them to be. In Jesus' name, amen. That's our house, the temple. Second thing is to pray for revival in the house that you and your family live in. The house that is your address. And you can read later Psalm 127 and be reminded there of giving our homes and our families over to the Lord. And this is pray for your spouse. And if you're single, your potential spouse or your other loved ones. And pray for your immediate family, your children, your grandchildren, your in-laws, parents, grandparents, brothers and sisters, and so forth. Pray for love to be shown, restoration if needed, clear communications, redeeming the time with each other. Seek forgiveness for any room that you might have opened to allow satanic or demonic entrance into your family. Pray for cleansing. Pray for strength. Pray for patience and forbearance with each other. Pray for a hedge of protection around your entire household. I think all of these are legitimate things that we can pray for. And like Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And that's what we want to do. So let's bow together in prayer. And there may be one of you who particularly wants to word a family prayer that God would do some of these things that are mentioned here in your home, in your family. And if so, just feel free to pray that out loud.
Father, I especially pray for my family, for my children, my grandchildren, my grandchildren, and the world that we live in. Just be close to them, Lord, and help them know that you're there. And just, there's so much that they're going to be faced with that our generation was never faced with. Mm. And I just ask you, Lord, to touch each one of them, especially my great-grandchildren, because they're gonna be living a lot longer than most of the rest of us.
Mm.
Thank you for being with us. Thank you for your Holy Spirit in my life every day. And I thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen. 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 The third area is a church house. So we've got our temple, our bodies, our house, our family, the address where we live, and the church house, household of faith. You know, the Apostle Paul said that there may be glory in the church in Ephesians chapter 3. So pray as Paul prayed for glory in the church, the glory of unity. Jesus prayed in 17 that we may be one like the Father and the Son are one. Pray for the glory of love in our church, for the glory of obedience, the glory of repentance and restoration and forgiveness. Pray for God to give us the glory of praise and worship and the glory of his unmistakable presence, like he spoke to Paul, I am with you. Pray for the glory of the Holy Spirit filling our people, our services and activities, even our meeting places. Pray that we will not quench the Spirit. Pray for the glory of conviction of sin. Pray for the glory of liberty, that the Spirit will be free to work as He will, and that Satan will not hinder, disrupt, distract, or divide. Pray for the connection with other households of faith, you know, other churches. Pray for reconciliation between brothers and sisters in Christ within the denomination. We are having right now in our Southern Baptist life some tough things, and we want to pray for reconciliation within the denomination and across denominational lines and across racial and cultural lines. So praying for the household of faith. Let's bow, and if somebody feels led to pray for our Dalewood Church particularly.
Fathers, we move into a time of important decisions here at Dalewood. Father, we pray for your family. We pray for all of these things that are laid out, for unity, for restoration, the quenching of Satan, that he would not have his way in any way in our church family. Father, that, Lord, you would be glorified in every way. Father, we want the best for our church, and we know that you do. Brother Sherrod, Father, there's a disruption in the band of Southern Baptist churches in some way, Father, so we pray for healing of that, healing of hearts and minds in that, Father. The Father, just as we commit Dalewood to you, Father, may you commit yourself to our handles, that you would show us the way in everything that we do, that we would be obedient and unified in spirit, Father, and we would most of all be obedient to you and to love you as you loved us.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Stephen. Finally, on the back page of this prayer guide, so we talked about the temple, our own body, our house. We talked about the family, our address where we live. We talked about the church house right here at Dalewood and prayed about that. Then pray for the courthouse, the state house, and the White House. That is, all those who inhabit and work in the places of influence in our nation. 1 Timothy 2, that's where the Apostle Paul says, you know, pray that we may be at peace. And Psalm 33 and 2 Chronicles 7:14 are some places in Scripture where we're taught about that. And so, to close out, pray that God will display His holiness and bring glory to Himself in the upcoming election. Of course, that one's a couple of years away, but and in His dealing with our nation. Already, you know, people are campaigning about the coming election, and so we need to pray for God's guidance. Pray that God will do whatever is necessary to bring our nation and its leaders to recognize His punishments for national and individual sins. Pray that the leaders will humble themselves before God. Pray that our leaders will acknowledge God as the supreme ruler of men and nations. Pray that our leaders will place their dependence on God for direction and trust Him for their help. Pray that our leaders will recognize the discipline and judgment of God and call upon the nation to repent and return to the Lord as their God. Pray that the people of our nation will also recognize the discipline and judgment of God and follow our leaders back to God and give God glory, thanksgiving, and praise when He accomplishes His purpose in our nation. And I'll just lead this prayer. Father, today I know I cannot speak for every leader in our land. I know I cannot speak for the president and the vice president and senators and congressmen. I cannot speak for mayors and governors. I cannot speak for state representatives. But Lord, I can speak to you about them. And so today, Lord, along with these praying people on the phone and here in the fireside room and here who are watching this service, Lord, we can together pray, God, bring America back to you. We've strayed so far from you, Lord, from the highest elected officials all the way down to those of us who sit in this prayer room right now, Lord. We've sinned. We've fallen short of the glory of God. We've stumbled and failed. We've broken promises. We've broken relationships and fellowship. We've spoken in ways that do not honor you. We've listened to things we shouldn't listen to. We've looked at things we shouldn't have looked at. Father, we are sinners in need of forgiveness. And we pray that in your grace and in your mercy, you will forgive us. Lord, we long to see America turn back to you. We've seen little signs, even in recent months, of revival breaking out here and there. But Lord, we long to see a nation once again turn back to you. And we know that it's really not the responsibility of the White House or the State House or the courthouse. It's the responsibility of my house and this church house. Lord, you've told if your people who are called by your name, if we would humble ourselves and turn from our wicked ways and seek your face, Lord, we would see revival in our land. You would heal it. And so, God, we confess our own lack of faith and lack of trust in you and obedience to you. And we ask that you would forgive us and that you would heal our land. Father, tomorrow, all across America, there will be groups of people gathered at courthouses and in churches. And many of them will be crying out to you. And I ask you, Lord, hear our prayer. Forgive our sins, heal our land. And may we say, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So be it, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.